We won't have much preparatory presentation material in these help sessions. The spirit of these help sessions instead is to mentor you in your journey in the self-guided stats boot camp. So what we intend you to do, and I'll give you a bit of a demonstration just to reiterate what happened last week to refresh you, make sure we're all on the same page, give you a chance to ask questions. And again, for the benefit of those who may not have joined us the first night, that you would have attempted to type and run the code from the bootcamp yourself. And we use these live sessions mostly to help you. And most of the help is honestly getting started. It's a very steep learning curve, but what we find is even students that have never encountered this material before, or never encountered statistics using R before, after a little bit of time, if you can engage and stick with the bootcamp, it will make sense. So we're here to support you in person and make sure that you can get over the curve, the learning curve. So we've had our first night. I did make a number of videos. I had a number of things to say that night, and I won't reiterate all of them tonight, but I've saved the videos and put the links up there for you. So if you like that sort of thing and you want to watch the videos and you missed the first night, or you'd like to watch things twice to relive it, they're there. Here we are tonight, the penultimate support session before the week of the module. So what we'll do mostly tonight is we will mostly have our breakout rooms, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions. I'm very pleased to see that Slack has been very busy. A lot of questions have been posted in the Slack channel. Keep it up. The Slack channel is there for you for the express purpose to give you support and help. We mentioned briefly last week that there is a protocol for asking questions and getting help. Now, we're not going to enforce it. We're not the chat police on the internet. But instead, the protocol, we mention it because it's the fastest way for you to get some help. If you haven't joined Slack yet, not everyone has, I'll just put the link there to join. Please join it with your email and your full name. For me, I would join my username Ed Harris so that we can all recognize each other. I don't have a Slack link on this page, but it has been in the emails, and I've just put it in chat, and I will add it to the page here. Just make sure I don't have a Slack link here somewhere. Nope, I'll add one to the Moodle page just for convenience. But I know this is yet another mode of communication, and people find that confusing, Slack that is. And I just wanted to say a few words of explanation to reiterate why we use it. One reason that I use it is that it is it's a system that is outside of the Harper Teams system, and a benefit that there is to using a system outside of that is that there aren't any constraints for you logging in. You can log in. What I've just found through experience is that the university gives you an email, and but people find it difficult to manage lots of emails. So you can log in with any email to Slack. I just ask that you use your real name so I know who you are. Another thing is that the Slack chat has tools that make it especially easy to format R code. And I don't have it set up at the moment like this. I have in the past, but we didn't use it very much, and so I've stopped updating it. But we can't actually run R code in Slack. It's not very fast, but the idea of that is beautiful and seems like it would be useful, but not many people did that. The main use for Slack is if you're frustrated with a little bit of code while you're working through the boot camp, or indeed the week of the the module, that you can give us enough information in there to tell us what you're doing in chat, post the code that you have to accomplish that, tell us where in the boot camp you are, ideally by pasting a link in to the exact web page, and we'll help. We'll help you. Oftentimes it's a small typographical error, or you're working through the exercises, and we will help you, and we have been doing that. I wanted to say, to reiterate something about the exercises. And already, even though I went through this the first week, a few people have mentioned it already. But you'll find the exercises are questions that are problems that have been solved on a particular bootcamp page. So the way that all of those questions are written is that it's intended that you read a bootcamp page. When there is code on one of the bootcamp pages, we'll go and run through a little example of this in a moment. But when there is code, the intention to experience the bootcamp is that you practice actually typing the code. I'll ask you, and I can explain to you, I'll ask you to type the code. I'll explain to you that I think you'll learn faster if you type the code. But I often have the feeling that a lot of people don't do that. Some people choose to just copy and paste the code. I can assure you that most of the code on my webpage, which I've personally typed, will run. It will run perfectly well. It'll be fine on your computer. But you will learn by making the odd little mistake when you type it, and it creates a muscle memory of typing. And the people that stand to benefit most from this are the people that have never done any computer coding. It will very quickly impart the tools in just a page or two for you to get over the learning curve. So it's something I highly recommend and emphasize. The thing that people notice about the questions is that I don't provide any answers. I don't provide explicit answers. There's several reasons for this. Well, one reason is, as I explained, every question in the exercises is a variation of a problem that I've already given an example of on that page and solved it. So the idea for the exercises is for you to type through the code and then apply the pattern of code that I've just demonstrated to a slightly different problem. So it asks you, the intention is implicit that you are to adapt some code you've just run to a new problem. Now, another reason that I don't provide explicit answers is that when we tackle any problem in a system like R, there are many, many ways to solve every problem. And I don't want to constrain the ways that you may solve a problem by providing you with an explicit answer. And you might be thinking, Ed, why don't you supply us with 10 different answers? That's even worse, because then it becomes confusing. So instead, the approach with these exercises is, and indeed one of the functions of these help sessions is that if you're having trouble with the exercises, we'll help you. We'll help you find your own answer. It's just that we're not going to provide explicit answers to all of them. I have a question in the chat. The question is that whether there is a convention for brackets, why sometimes you use round brackets, sometimes you use square brackets, and sometimes no brackets. You can add another kind of bracket. There are also curly brackets in there. We use all three kinds in the boot camp. And the one answer for this is that, yes, Shimek has answered one answer for the round brackets that it follows a function name. So round brackets only always follow a function. For example, the mean function will always have round brackets. The standard deviation SD function always have brackets. Data.frame, always brackets. But you can also use round brackets for simple math. So we might use the round brackets for the mean function. We might use the round brackets, though, just in using R as a calculator if we wanted to calculate something and explicitly tell R the order of operation. Something like an expression I've just put in the chat, 5 plus 2 in the round brackets multiplied by 5. So that would tell the R system to make the adding operation of 5 plus 2 first. The brackets force that, and then 5. Now the square brackets are different. The square brackets are used to note the address for data objects. So if you have a vector, let's say that you made a vector of the numbers 4, 5, and 6, and you wanted to pull out the second number in the vector, you can think of the way that I described this in the bootcamp page is we always use the square brackets to as like an address of where some data value lives. So we only use the square brackets with data objects to note those addresses. Okay, and there are some uses for the other brackets. We demonstrate those on the pages, but that is essentially the main difference. They're not interchangeable between one another. The index, exactly. Okay, so that covers where we've been and where we are. What we're going to be doing, no problem, Eric, see you in a moment. What we're going to be doing tonight is in a few moments, I'll stop the video and I will invite you to ask any general questions about the course. And then, like most of these sessions, tonight there are not a huge amount of people, of students, compared to associate lecturers. So what we'll do tonight is probably have a couple of breakout rooms, and we'll be able to interact with you one-to-one and just answer questions about the bootcamp. Or if people don't have questions at the moment, you can use this time to actually work through the bootcamp on your own. Sometimes I've noticed that associate lecturers, we don't have a program necessarily to follow. This is just a time like an open lab for you to have support when and if you need it. Sometimes, though, I have noticed that some of my associate lecturers will want to give a demonstration. That's fine as well. And if that's bothering you and you don't want the demonstration, you can mute your speakers and work at your own pace, or you can leave the chat. These are optional, purely optional sessions just to help. So you can use them as you wish. And what's going to happen after this next week, we'll have one more support session. Now the idea for this is that you make an attempt to get through the entire boot camp and run the code. Now we don't expect anyone to master this material in the boot camp. I know that is very challenging. I know it is very challenging. And remember what the point of the bootcamp is. The point of the bootcamp is to expose you, make you aware that these tools exist and how the R system works, so that when the module week comes, you're not starting from a standing start. That is the purpose. Mastery of this stuff. I often think that some people become frustrated because they want to master this stuff. We're trained in various levels of education to be given passively some information, take it on, and then be given a series of very simple tasks and where you can just nail it right after you're given those trivial, simple little tasks. This is not like that. This is something that is very important for being a practicing scientist. And it's a work in progress for most scientists who are not trained formally as statisticians for their whole career. So some of you will be taking the first steps in that. And you may be thinking that the only reason that you're taking it is because it's a mandatory part of your course. But reflect on that just a moment, that it's mandatory because it's such an important part of your training. And I just want to reiterate a high note that we're all here to help. And all of us have been on the same journey that you're on. We all began somewhere, and we are just here to help. And this only exists for your benefit, as far as I'm concerned. So we'll do anything we can within reason to help. What will happen after the next meeting before the module week is that the link will be up for the module website. Several people have asked this question, and so I thought I did address it last week, but I thought I'd address it again here tonight. So the material for this module is 100% online, and I've given you a schedule in the email, and it's also here on the Moodle page for some meetings during the week of the module. Now, the boot camp material is, I explained last week that I intend you to begin at the first page and consecutively run all of the code and read the information and attempt the exercises as well. And it's completely self-guided with these support sessions. The module week's a bit different. What I have observed in the past is that some students don't have enough time to get through all of the boot camp material. And you know, it can cause some stress. So I want to reassure you that you don't have to get through it all, and you don't have to master everything to be able to successfully get into the module material. It's just getting the idea of how the tools work. When we start the module week, it's a bit different. There are some lectures, some traditional lectures, where I will usually introduce some concepts. I don't make any assumptions about a background here, other than that you have engaged at some level with the boot camp. So I make the assumption that you have enough of an understanding about the R system so that you can work through the labs. But the lectures, I start assuming no background knowledge in statistics, and I build it up very slowly. Well, if you have taken a rigorous statistics class for practicing scientists, say as part of an undergraduate degree before you came here, especially if you've taken one that that uses R, you might find a lot of the lectures very easy, and you might find a lot of the labs very easy. And I take it up to a point in the module where it's the minimum standard that's suggested by the Royal Veterinary College, the Royal Society for Biology, and other societies, animal nutrition journals, entomology journals, general ecology, zoology, wildlife, a standard so that you can be able to weigh in with your own opinion for studies that are in the scientific literature. So we go up to we start with the simple statistics, correlation, regression, ANOVA. We'll go a little bit more detail than the boot camp does on those topics. Then just a little bit further to linear models, the general linear model. So that is the minimum standard that's been identified for master's level practicing scientists, and it's the level that we go to. But through the week, I'll suggest a schedule. that you stick to for consuming the lectures and the labs. What I have sometimes found is that students will say, oh, I didn't feel, I'm going to go back to do that boot camp again, and I'm going to do that boot camp until I'm really, really happy with it before I start your modules, and I'll get to the module content later on. That strategy, I've never seen it work. It fails. That strategy is not viable. Instead, what I suggest is that get as much as you can from the boot camp, then move on to the materials. And I will suggest a schedule each day. And it's best if you keep up with that schedule. And even if you don't complete the previous day, to go ahead and move on. Because if you have engaged even to a moderate degree with the boot camp, while the boot camp has a linear necessity, you need to do one before you move on to the other. We don't necessarily need to have that for the module labs. And so I recommend that you try to keep up with them. And rather than lingering on the early stuff, if you're going slower, drop it and move on to the next lab the next day when we do that. So we'll talk about that the week of the module delivery. Those days during that week are Monday through Friday, the week of November 7th. And there will be two support sessions each day. They're optional. They're just there for your support. So it'll be a similar setup to here. We'll assume that you would watch the videos for the lectures outside of these support sessions. And mainly, you can use the support sessions like an open lab to complete the lab materials. Then after the module week, this is far into the future. It's so far into the future, I can barely think about it, but it's in January. Now, I believe your assessment is due on the 2nd of February. Someone may tell me in a moment, but it doesn't really matter. It's so far in the future, it's just theoretical. I've set up 4 optional support sessions for the assessment. And you can begin your assessment. You have questions, getting your code straight. Part of your assessment is to create a reproducible analysis in R that will run 100% for someone else. And that's part of the assessment. I will run every line of code that you write, I assure you. And I'll probably make suggestions in the comments for it. And if you like feedback, there'll be plenty of it. I like to give a lot of feedback. If I ask you to do some work for me, it's only right that I give you personalized, copious feedback if you value it. So you can hone that code in these labs. They're very popular. I find that people tend not to religiously attend the earlier support sessions, but they do tend to come to these. And they're very popular and crowded sometimes for that reason. And that's what's coming. We'll start those on Wednesday, same format, 5 to 7. They're completely optional, but they're popular. Now, we'll launch the assessment a little bit later on, probably by video during the module week, or possibly if it has been through our internal process a little bit early enough for next week. I may go ahead and introduce it next week at the support session and video it that week. But what it consists of is an assigned data set. Every student will have a different data set, and it will be different from last year. I'll never have assigned this to anybody before. And your goal will be to showcase the tools that we cover in the module. Someone asked last week if I expected a novel piece of research. I do not. I expect you to show me that you can formulate hypotheses given some data. And by hypotheses, I mean statistical hypotheses that you test in a reproducible way with the tool set and communicate them back in a brief way. Not writing a report, summarizing a statistical analysis. So there's a lot of guidance on that, and that'll be forthcoming. I think that is all of the material I wanted to say. Can I first ask any of the associate lecturers, is there anything that any of you would like to say at this point or advise?
No, not really.
No?
I've got an observation, Ed, which is the website, you know, that your new bootcamp website is very clearly divided into two modules. So you've got the first module being just R, you know, basic, the language itself, and second, then it moves on, you know, so that's sections 1 to 6, and then it picks up again at 7, and then we're into the stats. When you come to set up rooms, and perhaps we could ask people which camp they fall into, where they would like help, basically. I'd rather be in the first camp if I get a choice.
You'd rather be in the first camp. You got it. Elected. Can we take a survey of people in chat? Can you tell me what's the largest page you've done? Can you just put the number of the page? Of the largest page you're working on now or that you have done in the chat, 1 through 12, which page are you on? I know there are more students than 4. 1 to 4, yep. Yeah. Okay. All right, I mean, most everyone is are still in the first part. That's what I expect, and it's fine. I think if you the hardest one, I mean, if we look at it from a million miles above the earth, the hardest material, some people would consider it to be the statistics, but actually I think by far the earlier modules are far harder because you're learning R and the learning curve is so much steeper. And once you get over that, the latter modules will seem simple from a code perspective to run, and then you can focus on the stats. Okay, so everybody's is early on in the modules. The way that these rooms work, for my own benefit, for the benefit of students and the benefit of the assistant lecturers, is that if it's code problems and conceptual problems, that's what these breakout rooms are for. And if anybody gets into a snag and there's something ambiguous or something you would like my opinion on, don't hesitate. And I'll have a separate room and I'll deal with anything that anybody wants to talk to me about. I'm available. I may float around and monitor what's going on and pip in if and when it's appropriate. But if you need me or want me, don't hesitate to call, whoever you are. Okay, students, any comments or questions at this stage? Any comments or questions? I think a thing that I wanted to say is that I haven't experienced it so intensively in previous years, but there's always a phase where we're all learning about what channels of communication to connect with each other on. And I will attempt to address all the channels, but I've been traveling this week and I noticed this year, and I haven't noticed it so much before, that people are sending me lots of direct messages and emails, and you're least likely to get fast help from me by doing that. We have a lot of ALs watching, a lot of associate lecturers there to help you, watching the general Slack channels, the open channels. And I'm the one with the least time, probably. I probably have the most bound calendar, and I just can't answer all of the questions. I've been getting a very large number of them. So please, if you can, unless there's a good reason not to, post questions in the Slack. Slack is better than email, and in the general chat. Really appreciate it if you can do that. I think then, if there aren't any questions, then I'm going to go ahead and open the rooms. This takes a few minutes to do this. So if you'll bear with me, I will